Alrighty. As I was staying together in the sanctuary, you there at home, sing along. Glad to report to you as we start 2021. God's love has never changed. He still loves us. Are you ready to sing? First time together in 2021. And let's just trust the Lord that this new year will be a good one to the glory of His grace. God so loved the world that He gave. Alas, and did my Savior bleed, and did my Sovereign die? What's important? Would He evil that sacred head for such a worm as I? Sing it. He loves me. Glory, glory, glory. He gave Himself to die for me because He loves me so. Was it for crimes that I have done? He groaned upon the tree. Hear it? Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. Everybody sing it to God. Thank You that You love us, Lord. Care for us. Provide for us. Play it, musicians, play it for us and pray it. Play it for the Lord. Glory. Greater love hath no man than this, and a man lay down his life for his friends. Then might I hide my blushing face. Thus might I hide my blushing face while His dear cross appears. Knees of my heart in thankfulness, and melt mine eyes with the tears. He loves me, yes, He loves me. He loves me, this I know. He gave Himself to die for me because He loves me so. He gave Himself. He gave Himself to die for me because He loves me so. Trish, good to have you back again. You missed last week because of the effects of COVID, and we love you and are so glad to have you back. And Eddie Hart, watching at home, our steel guitar player, he hasn't been here in so long. He's had COVID and he's in the hospital, ICU. He gets home and he's just still struggling, still weak. Brother Eddie, we love you. We miss you. Wish you were here, and maybe it won't be but a week or two that you'll be back. This COVID just holds on to people, especially the elderly. Now, my mother got through it, but she had a horrible day yesterday, pain in her chest and all that thoracic area. And they afraid she's had pneumonia yesterday, but then last night she was doing much better. So just pray for all these precious people. And as I stand here, I call all the preachers up. You that have announced your call, anointed of God to preach, get on up here. We're going to pray. Everybody else gather around. We got so many people to pray for. I just can't keep up with all of them. We got several people sick. Of course, the James Little family, the funeral today. And then Billy Dean's family at funeral tomorrow. As most of you know by now, Brother Dick Roten passed away and slipped out of this world to be with Jesus. And we want to remember his family in our prayers today. And I'll be honest, I've been in the ministry for 50 years or plus, I guess, now. And it's just, I've never seen it like this. We've had so many deaths in our community in the last 6 weeks. It's just unbelievable. And I think we've got funeral home called yesterday. I don't know, five or six this week, something like that. It's just incredible. Ourself, and there's been like 70 deaths in the last 6 weeks or something like that in our general vicinity. So let's pray for everybody that's sick that you know, everybody that's sorrowful that you know. As you know, this is God's house, and Jesus wanted us, as he said so long ago, to make it a house of prayer. So when I ask you to share your requests, and of course pray for the meeting in Georgia, pray for all the local churches today, everywhere around the country and world, and let's just believe God. But when you speak these names out to God, then you're doing that as an act of faith in God's grace. You know someone sorrowful, a family that's going through so much, and there are so many. Oh, don't forget to keep praying for Angelina and little Jesse and Chase and that family and all of these, so many. Ain't you glad God knows what we need before we ask him? Lift your request. Just start speaking out those names of the lost, of the sick, of the struggling. Go right ahead. You know people that need prayer today. So just, little Ellie's still having problems. We're believing God. Lynn Davis's daughter, I hear, see, we're here. We're getting all kinds of names. Get on around here some more. We got plenty of room up here. But let's just pray. Make your bench an altar. You at home, pray. Don't be looking at people. Look to God.
Right.
Heaven's sake, if you're looking in trying to critique and criticize, you're the one that needs to fall down and get saved, as far as I'm concerned. Hallelujah to God. Pray, men. Pray, women. Pray, young people. Everybody, call on God there at home. Jesus.
So many out there that's finding out who we are, Lord God. Lord, we ask, God, that you take care of the customer lives, God. And I pray, God, that today that they'll be relieved from that. Father, Lord God, there's so many out there with cancer, suffering from illness, God. Lord, I pray that you touch them and help them this morning, Father, Lord God. And I pray you help them get healed from that awful, dreaded disease, God, Lord. And I pray for the lost this morning, Father, Lord. The lost is so many, God, in the sick and dying world. God, Lord, I pray, God, that you'll just touch them and save them today, God, that today will be their day of salvation. Father, Lord God, I pray for the singers here this morning. God, Lord, I pray that you'll cover them this morning. God, Lord, I pray that the Holy
God,
Spirit of
God will
drift off their lips.
In your righteousness, God.
God, I pray for the
fill
man.
Us up with love and compassion.
God, I pray you close him in his calling, God. Lord, I pray you hide him behind the cross. God, I pray you give him liberty to preach.
Lord, we've got to go on into this new
like
year.
Never preached him before, Father.
God,
Lord, God, I pray for the hearts of those that are out here listening. God, Lord, I pray that it won't fall on dead ears, God.
Oh, Lord. Lord, we're believing for every one of these, God. We know you're still a miracle working, God. I pray, God, that you'll hear the prayers of those, oh God, that love you today. Oh, Lord. You are welcome here, God. You're gathering up every prayer being prayed. You hear us all. And you are able and you are mighty. You have no equal, much less a superior. You are God, and beside you there is none else.
Thankful for that, God. I'm thankful for what he did. I'm thankful that he went to that
Thank you for sharing
I'm thankful that he
your
gave
strength
life, God, and he went to that old tomb,
and your mercy
God, that it,
and your grace
that he got up, God, and he
your goodness
tomb, God, on his own power. God, he didn't need no
and
power
showering
God.
Us
and, God, he
and
was able to lay down his
surrounding
life.
Us with your
God,
glory.
I'm glad that he did that, Father. Lord, I'm glad that he sits on heaven strong this morning, making intercession for us sinners.
Lord, we are so
Lord,
grateful
I'm thankful for that, Father,
and so humble.
God, Lord, I just want to give you glory this morning. God, that's what it's all about, is we're here to praise you, to give you the glory.
Who are we
God,
that you are mindful of us?
This morning, God, help us to hear from you. Father, Lord, we'll give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory, God. For it's in my King, Yahshua's name that I pray. It's in Jesus, the Holy of Man. Thank you, Lord. Yes, God. Thank you, Jesus.
I hope you feel like I do, that we're so humble that God meets with us. Stay humble, church, and God will continue to bless into 2021. Trust Him for everything in your personal life. Love Him, honor Him, glorify Him. Follow Him faithfully. You cannot purchase this. You cannot achieve this through human means. If God is pleased, He is pleased. And His holy, sacred presence, we are in the embassy of heaven this morning, in the very presence of the Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ and God our Father. Now let us praise Him with our voices and praise Him on the instruments and praise Him from our hearts. Hallelujah. Yes, I'm sorry, Max. Praise the Lord. We'll do that in just a minute. Hallelujah.
One. Night upon the sea, a ship was tossing to and fro.
Thank you.
lost, but he brought me in. His love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Free at last.
And gave me a place in his family. If you can say, I am a child of God, what you're doing is giving all glory to the King who took us in. You couldn't get more helpless than I was. You couldn't get any more poor than I was. I was down there lost. Misery here and perdition over there. But now I've got mercy here and a beautiful place over there. All because of the splendor and the grace and the mercy and the goodness of our God. Worship Him and glorify Him and love on Him a little bit this morning.
You are worthy.
heaven sings, my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
You can stay standing, sit down, whatever you want to do. Just keep playing that, Trish. Hallelujah to God. I see a note here, Ann Davis's daughter, Karen. I would imagine that's a request. Teresa, you and Max, come on up. I'd like for all the preachers to gather around here at the front. We're going to anoint them with oil if they've called for us. Hallelujah. Let's see. I know Jimmy Shoup is an elder here. I don't see any other of our elders here. So preachers, that's what you are basically. So come on. Charlie, you get down there and help too. How great thou art. Oh my. Glory, glory, glory. There's Luther. He's here. Praise God. All right, everybody, let's just pray. If you're struggling today, if you've got a heartache today or some problem, whatever it is, cast it upon the Lord. He is able. You know, He's saving souls and doing miracles. What direction are you looking at? I don't know where you're looking at, but I've seen all kinds of folks saved here this week. I've seen miracles the last few weeks. I've seen people live. What's your problem? If you're down and out and worried, look to God. Don't look to yourself. Don't listen to others. Don't listen to the naysayers. Don't listen to a lie. It'll get you discouraged, but the truth will deliver you today. So here's this oil, men. Here you go. We're going to do what God says do. And we're going to anoint. Yes, Jesus. Teresa, we anoint you in the name of Jesus. We're believing God for a miracle. They're going to pull out of this COVID and get strength back in a matter of hours. I think God can give them strength right now. What's your need today? God meets needs. Philippians 4:19. My God shall supply all your need according to His riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Anybody in the house, especially if you're not saved yet, you need to get saved. If you got, are you toting burdens and problems? That ain't God's fault, that's your fault. He told you to cast it on Him. And when you cast it on Him, you ain't got it anymore. When you cast your cares on the Lord. I'm still praising God for Lily's testimony. I'm still touched by that. Praise God. Well, we believe God. We believe God right now in the name of Jesus. It's done. Praise God. We believe in the power of God. And we believe in the gospel of God. Well, here's a song we're going to sing that is an older song. And it's right out of the book of Acts, hearing the Macedonia call. When people were in Europe and they hadn't had the gospel yet, and Paul had that vision, come over and help us. This world needs help, whether they believe it or know it or not. And what disperses and gets rid of darkness? What? Say it loud. The light. Who is the light? He's the God of the gospel, right? And he said, preach the gospel to every creature. I believe we will remember it. Strike me off there, Trish, and the band, and let's give it a whirl. We're going to sing this because this is what we're supposed to be doing. Y'all remember it? I don't think we've sung it in a while. There's a call comes ringing o'er the restless wave. Send the light, send the light. There are souls to rescue, there are souls to save. Send the light, send the light, send the light. The blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore. Here we go now, second verse. We have heard the Macedonian call today. And a golden offering at the cross we lay. Lift your voice. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. Let us not grow weary in the work of love. Let us gather jewels for a crown above. Let's do it, church. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. Well, give God some glory. That might have been a little different words from a different book. I think there's different lyrics there. Let its radiant beams light the world forevermore. I've never heard those lyrics before. I'm sorry I was singing something else, but I think I like those lyrics better than the old ones. Or that's probably the real old ones that goes beyond the songbook that I led singing out of when I was a kid. Well, praises be unto God. Trish, you got a voice? No? All righty. Y'all got a song? Come on and sing us one. Y'all got a song? We'll have a couple songs before we open the Word of God. That'll get us in the Word of God by 15 after. Praises be unto God. We ain't never been programmed here, ladies and gentlemen. We just let the Lord have his way. And we're grateful, though, that you're here. God bless you. You pray for the Bises. They'll sing us a song. They'll get ready here in just a second. Praises be unto God. Be very, very, very much in prayer for all of these precious folk who need our prayers so desperately in this hour. But we've got a God who is the sovereign God, and he is with us. He said in Isaiah 41:10, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will strengthen thee. And yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. That means the full strength of God is at your disposal for your benefit. Now, how about that? He loves you. I want to say a great big thank you for all of you who traveled so far to help set the tent up. If you went there, would you lift your hand? You that were there, God bless you. Praise the Lord. All of you, hallelujah. Now we're going to be praying for all that that's going on in Georgia, and we're believing God for the fire of God to spread all across this nation. Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Come on, y'all. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Had a wonderful time. Hey, praise the Lord. Had a wonderful time going to Georgia and back. It's a quick trip. But we had fun, enjoyed ourselves so much, get to fellowship with other brothers and sisters in the Lord who love the Lord. And that's what I feel like God's doing this morning. He's wanting us to talk about His love and His mercy and His grace today. Amen. Had a request for this song. It's called Love is Stronger. The evil and the light can't stand in front of the love of Jesus Christ. Amen. The darkness can't stand. The evil can't stand in front of the light of Jesus Christ and His love and His mercy and His grace. If you wasn't here Wednesday and Thursday, you missed a great two nights of revival and deliverance. Hello, I'm still enjoying that meal from last week. So praise God. Y'all just bear with us as we sing this song, Love is Stronger. Praise God.
Word of God right now, if y'all don't mind. Is that all right? Because I believe God is in that. They didn't know this thing orchestrated by man. That song, Love is Stronger, on this first Sunday together starting this new year. Let's just keep that thought going. John chapter 21 in your Bibles. John 21. And as a text verse, I think we will read verse 15. Boy, I love to hear the pages of God's Word turning in the house of God. So precious, so precious. For many, many years, we have reverenced the reading of the Word of God by standing to our feet with it open in our hands, trusting God to deliver it to our hearts. This is soul-saving, life-changing, the Word of God is. So verse 15 of John 21, so when they had dined, Jesus saith to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He had done fixed him a little fish meal there, Jesus had. Verse 12, he said, come and dine. I hope you've dined with Jesus many times in your personal life. Not just at church, but all the time. And he picks out Peter. He specifies. You remember Peter denied him three times. Denied even knowing him. Cussed his name. Then went out and wept bitterly. Is that why Jesus asked this question three times? I'm sure that struck the heart of Peter when he asked him three times, do you love me? But this first time he said, do you love me more than these? And he said, Lord, yes, you know I love you. And Jesus said, feed my lambs. Second time, Peter said the same thing. Jesus said, feed my sheep. Third time, it kindly really got to Peter. It grieved him. And he said, Lord, you know everything. You know how weak I am. You know how a failure I was. You know all about me. But one thing, Lord, you do know that I love you. Jesus said, feed my sheep. So this morning, as we start out this year, do we really love Jesus more than these? God, humble heart, bow knee, ask you, God, speak to me, speak through me, help us all. And you will, from your word, that we would be equipped to continue your work into 2021. And you are the eternal God. You will be identically the same a gazillion light years from now as you were a gazillion light years in eternity past. For from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. So help us, little finite humans, to glorify you as such. And may we, as your adopted born again children, honor you above all else and truly love you more than these. This petition with our praise we lay before you in the highest, holiest name. Jesus, your only begotten, our wonderful, precious Savior and dearest friend any of us could ever have. Thank you for giving him to us, O Father. Amen and amen. Well, keep your Bibles open now. more than these. If you've been to the Holy Land and you've been to Capernaum, that's a little town there on the northern shore of Galilee where Jesus kind of headquartered his earthly ministry, especially as he started. Peter lived there. He had his house there. He had his business there. He had his business partners, James and John, there. He had his fishing fleet there. He had all of his commercial equipment there. But he had his children there. His wife was there. His mother-in-law, his family. Everything that encompassed Peter's life was within eyesight when Jesus said, "Do you love me more than thee?" Now, I believe they were right near his boat. I believe they were right near his office. I believe they were right near his house. If you go down that shore of Galilee, you can still see Capernaum and the buildings up there on the hillside. So I believe what Jesus was saying, "Peter, do you love me more than anything in this world and more than anything in your life?" Jesus just bamboozled their minds when he told them one time, if you follow me, you're going to have to hate everybody else. Now, Jesus said he didn't contradict himself. He's talking to us as personal disciples because he tells us to love everybody. So he certainly wouldn't contradict his own word and tell them to hate everybody. But in the comparison of the words there, he was saying, what I'm doing for you, who I am, what I'm doing for you, where I'm going for you, what I'm going to provide for you, you ought to know that, you ought to recognize that. And that's the greatest thing. We've got to live forever. We've got to have salvation. We've got to have the provision of God in our life. So the level of our love for Jesus in comparison to all the other forms of love ought to be such a high a region there that in comparison everything else just pales. That's why he said you can't love others more than you love me. This agape love is the sacrificial sovereign love of God. We in this world today, it's basically eros. It's flesh. Eros in the Greek, and that's a word that's used, the English word love. DR was talking about pornography the other night. Pornography is one of the biggest businesses in America. They say a majority of churchgoers are absolutely addicted to it. But let me tell you something, physical acts, physical love, that ain't love. That comes from the Greek eros. It's fleshly, it's carnal, it's of the world. And who's the god of the world? The devil. But it's not just sexual, it can be social, it can be sensual. Sensual does not necessarily, in true definition, equate to sexual. Sensual equates to anything that is titillating and stimulating and pleasure giving to my flesh. Therefore, the number one thing, it's not perverted sex. It's ungodly pride. That's the worst thing in eros. We love ourselves. That's immaturity. I want my way above everybody else's way. That's one of the biggest problems in marriages today, has been for the past many, many decades in America. I've told people, but used to when we would do that type of ministry, you better love your wife the way she needs you to love her, not the way you want to love her. Her needs are superior to yours. That's not anywhere in eros. Eros, it's me, mine, and my. That's who it is. Number one, that's it. That's eros. Then you've got phileha. Then you've got starge. Starge is a family love. Mamas, you love that child, she's an extension of your life. That's a higher level of love. Phileha is another higher level of love. It's brotherly love. It's community involvement. It's trying to help other people. But still, we've got that human element in it. And those are inferior to the superior of phileha and phileho. Agape and agapo. That is God's love. That's eternal love. That's unconditional love. Most people in the other three forms of love, love because of what we're going to get back. But God Almighty couldn't get anything back. It wasn't 1 ounce of having anything to do with getting. It was 100% giving. That's agape love. I couldn't have nothing but sin. He had eternal salvation, yet he was willing to make the trade and sacrifice himself. It wasn't easy. He who knew no sin would be made sin. The very terror that would strike the heart of God would to become sin, the very thing he couldn't look upon. But because his love is a total, sacrificial, eternal love with everlasting results in mind. You see, God didn't say, yes, I was a filthy little dirty orphan, but God's eyes filled with the divine love that he had, he saw the potential in this little person. I didn't have to always stay a little hungry, starved, helpless orphan. He knew I'd make him a pretty good son. He knew you would make him a wonderful daughter. And he birthed you into his family and dressed you in the righteousness of Christ. And he has a calling. He has a destiny. He sees your potential. And he has patience to keep working with you. He won't backhand you down when you keep failing him. If you're really saved, he loves you. And that love is an inseparable love. We ought to thank God that he loves us. And he does. So that was crucial and important. Peter, do you love me more than anything? Will you love me more than you love your wife? Will you love me more than you love your family? Will you love me more than your money? Will you love me more than your reputation? Will you love me more than your religious training? Will you love me more than you love yourself? Will you give your soul and your life to me and let me lead you? Look down here at these last words in verse 19. Jesus simply said, follow me. 77 times in the Gospels, you'll see the word follow. A follower of Jesus, that word follow, got it for you on the screens if you'd like to take a snapshot of it so you can follow this and understand this and apply this to your life. We've heard about following Jesus. We've sung Fishers of Men and all of that. But when you study the word follow, you'll find it means that that is a companion of Jesus. That is one who has union with Jesus Christ. And that Christ is the ultimate, absolute Lord and leader of your life. Following Jesus means going in the same direction as the one leading. Following Jesus is literally in the Bible, following his footsteps. Listen to 1 Peter 2, 20 and 21. For what glory is it when you have been buffeted for your faults, ye shall take it patiently. But if when you are buffeted and suffered for doing good and what's acceptable, but if ye, when ye do well, you suffer for it, you take that patiently, that's acceptable with God. For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that ye should follow his steps. Selfishness and all other forms of love, I don't even like to be rebuked when I'm doing pretty good. I sure don't like to be rebuked when I'm doing bad either. As a matter of fact, in the natural inclination, we don't like to be buffeted or rebuked at all. But here Jesus is teaching about a level of love to him that we would maintain the integrity and honor of our love for him even when we don't get things the way we want the things to be. That's a great lesson from God. The results of that love, listen, are a maturing, enhancing, there it is, and an expansion and growth in the grace and knowledge of Christ. How many times have we quoted 2 Peter 3, 17 and 18? Ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things, beware lest ye also be led away with the error of the wicked. You don't want to do that. and fall from your steadfastness. Brothers and sisters, starting into 2021, we need to maintain steadfastness. Don't ever be guilty, me, you, or anybody else, of falling from our steadfastness that we have in Him and to Him, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, and to Him be glory both now and forever. Amen. So there's a little bit about the word follow here in our text. Now you said, feed my lambs and feed my sheep. Look at the word feed. Means to care for, provide for, and to nourish. Bottom line, it is simply this, as Christ has told us countless times through the pen of Paul, Peter, James, John, and others in the New Testament, that we were to exhort or encourage one another. You look up here at this preacher, one of the main jobs of a pastor in a pulpit, no matter who the pastor is to feed the sheep. And that is to encourage the sheep. One of the greatest jobs that any pastor, any elder has, a teaching elder in that role and office, is to give out the bread of heaven and the meat of the word of Almighty God. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 11, he'll feed his flock like a shepherd. He'll gather the lambs with his arms and carry them in his bosom. Ain't you glad the shepherd's got you as his little sheep in his care and shall gently lead these that are with young? Jesus said, even so, it is not the will of your Father which is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish or lose their well-being. So not just the preacher, but all God's children are to encourage one another as the flock. Not discourage, but encourage. Not to shear and scalp, but to help and encourage along the way. You know what a sheep is? That's the purchased property of the shepherd. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers. Listen, you preachers here and everybody else. Feed the church of God, watch this, which he has purchased with his own blood. Oh, I love what Paul told him there in Ephesians 1:14, which is the earnest of our inheritance. Jesus put the down payment down, and he's got the full payment in his own self as the great high priest and head of the church until the redemption of the purchased possession. That's peculiar, people. That's who we are. We've been purchased by the blood of the Lamb. We don't belong to the world. We belong to the Word. And so we're not supposed to be working out in the world. We're supposed to be working for the Word, going out into the world as lights in this old dark place that we are sharing with each other. So caring for each other from justification through sanctification all the way to glorification. Us sheep in the family of God, purchased possession. Love can only be seen in the actions produced within itself. See that? I hope you will take note of that and get that this morning. I can't smell love. I can't touch it. I can only see it from its actions. I see hate when I see some terrorist cutting a head off. I see hate when I hear people slinging accusations and criticizing everything, even churchgoers. I was kept thinking the other night when everybody's being so blessed, you know, and DR giving his testimony, and it hits home to so many people. But you're looking at the old preacher, I ain't got no testimony like that. I ain't never been to beer joint. I ain't never been drunk on nothing but the Holy Ghost, I reckon. So I don't know nothing about all that stuff. But I know the same Jesus that saved me saved y'all. And I know I was just as lost, just as hellbound. But to just be frightened of hell, which is a good thing. You've heard me say, I never did want to go to heaven. I got afraid about going to hell. But repentance has to do with sin. All through the book of Romans, I think I mentioned this under the tent preaching either at Washington or down in Roberta, Georgia, that you can read all through the 16 chapters of Romans and you won't see the word hell one time. But you'll see the word sin several times. Precious souls go to hell because of sin. Sin is a reproach to any people. Sin is what severed Adam from God in the beginning. That's why Jesus had to be made sin. I am a sinner. Not because I sin because I am a sinner. And I cannot be changed by some religious experience. Fear of hell may drive me down to an altar. But my faith in my help is what brings salvation. And except you repent, Jesus said, you'll perish. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And the destination of sin is a Christless eternity, a burning hell. I know it's out there, outer darkness. That's the destination to where lost souls will pay the debt that they theretofore didn't owe. But when they came to that age of accountability, we were all accountable to God for our sin. And you can't cover sin with church fellowship or church membership. You can be a preacher. You can be a deacon. You can sing like a canary. But you'll die and go to hell if you don't ask God to have mercy on you as a sinner. That's why one of the reasons churches are filled with lost people. They had a religious experience. They joined the church. And now they have grown to be bosses of the church. That's why they can defy and violate the word of God without any conviction. Have you asked God to take away your sin? God loves us so much that he died and paid the price of sin. Look at those precious verses in 1 John 4. Do you love me more than these, Peter? Is my love really reigning in you now? He that loveth not knoweth not God. For God is love. In this was manifested the love of God toward us because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation of our sins. Beloved, if God loved us, we ought also to love one another. David Bice, you are the workmanship of Jesus. I can't say I love you and not love you. I can't say I love Jesus and then not love the one that was begotten of Jesus. I see Jesus in you. You're the handiwork and workmanship of God. So that love within us creates that love amongst one another. You love me, I love you because of him. That's the connection. Hallelujah to God. I ain't perfect, but God still loves me. You ain't perfect, but I've got to still love you. Hallelujah to God. I'm not perfect, but you still love me. How come? Because of him. If you ain't got it by now, 2021, God's people needs to reiterate and know it's all about him. That's where it's at. In and of and by the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, love is the attitude of God Almighty toward his Son. And love can only be seen in its actions produced within itself. Now, the most powerful expression of love within all humanity is Christ. Ephesians 2, 4 and 5, God rich in mercy for his great love wherein he loved us. Wherein when we were dead in sins, he hath quickened us together. Hallelujah to God with Christ. Look at that. Together with Christ. Man, that ought to make somebody want to run a lap around the house of God. It's because of him, Charlie, that you got saved. It's because of him, because you got healed. when they told me, get your funeral ready, I said, don't give up on old Brother Charlie yet, Doc. Hallelujah to God. Then they stood in the ICU at Abingdon Hospital and said, Charlie Ham is a true miracle of God. Jesus brought you out. But can I go ahead and say, had you breathed your last, and they laid, and I come down there and there's your lifeless body laying in that bed. Glory to God. I told Charlie, kicking up gold dust on the boulevards of heaven, we're a winner either way. He doesn't love somebody more because you get an earthly miracle. We've already got an everlasting miracle. To him be honor and glory now and always. Laura, you'd have went to the house if you'd got, but God ain't done with you yet. So use that miracle to show everybody else the might of God. And then if we go to a funeral, we're going to glorify God in that too. Glorify him in everything because we love him more than these. Turn over to Romans 13, please. Romans 13. Hallelujah. Ain't you glad we're saved by faith? But boy, I like the feeling around here. People said it visited the other night. Boy, Spirit, I said, you ought to be in here about 2 o'clock in the morning sometimes praying. Whew, I ain't going to talk. That's between me and God. Hallelujah. Holy angels stroll the catwalk. Hallelujah to God. And when they sing, you ain't heard singing till you've heard the angels sing praises. Showed you this many times, let me show you one more time. The most powerful exercise of love is never from feeling, but is from our faith in Christ and our following of Christ. The most powerful exercise of love. Love worketh no ill to his neighbor. Period. Don't start adding to it, church person. If you add to or take away, you'll be added to the plagues and taken away your name out. Read the last of the book in Revelation. Love worketh no ill to his neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Now, chapter 15, verse 2, let every one of you please his neighbor for his good to edification. So here's love, more than these. You mark it down if you haven't yet, because I've hit this many times, God leading me through the years. Ill will to no one, ill will to none, good will to everyone. Get her down and get it in your heart. Ill will to none, good will to everyone. Now let's recap a few things that God's telling us here this morning. Love constrains our obedience to Christ's commandments and always runs opposite to our own natural inclinations. 1 Corinthians 2:14, the things of God are only spiritually discerned. They cannot be naturally discerned. When you start trying to interpret the Word of God with the natural mind of Adam, then it just becomes another religious book. It doesn't bring real power from God. Jesus said in John 14:15, if you love me, keep my commandments. I'm going to share with you, brothers and sisters and friends, this morning a verse that perplexes a lot of people. It's 1 Corinthians 16:22. If any man love not the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be anathema maranatha. Anathema maranatha, look at that. It's very sobering. I could stand here and try to teach on that for an hour, but you can study it out for yourself. And I know there's a lot of disagreement, debate, doctrinally and all that, but you boil it down to this. The death of the Lord Jesus Christ glorified God. He was crucified for all of us. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I'll draw all men unto me. What's the attraction of the cross? It's that a holy God became sin for an old sinner like me so that I could be the righteousness of God in him. No greater love can ever be found. You see, for a righteous person, some may dare to die. But Paul said in Romans 5, yet while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. The wages of sin is death. The gift of God is eternal life. Now, if that goes over your head and doesn't sink down and permeate and drive and propel your heart, then something is wrong. Anathema, that's the authorized cursing. and excise and excommunication of someone from God. How serious. Maranatha literally translates the coming of Christ. And the bottom line, this, people that have been deceived and are not really saved, and those that are lost out there in the world, they will have nothing but misery now. That's anathema. And Maranatha, the misery now will pale in comparison to the perdition and the punishment and the fire beyond this world. I get so frustrated sometimes with church people who obviously do not know the Word of God. See, their hearts revealed by what they say. And I've rebuked a few of them through the years, but it goes right over their head because they're so proud. They're convinced absolutely that they're right with God. But the Lord's finally showed me going into 2021. I'm the one that's helped you for all your life. You don't really need to try to appease people. Don't feel sorry for them because they can't feel sorry for themselves. They're anathema. They've been deceived. They think they're saved. They think they're better than everybody else. And they don't know anything about self-denial and self-sacrifice. And really, in reality, their life's a misery. They don't like anybody. They don't like anything. It's always criticizing. Always putting down. Always growling and grumbling. Misery now. Hell then. Anathema, Maranatha. But we got to keep loving them. Keep being patient with them. I wish they would change. But a leper can't change his spots. It has to be a heart transformation that only God can do. Turn with me, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. A few verses here. 2 Corinthians 5. A recap real quick. True love, loving God more than anything in this world, constrains our obedience to Christ's commands, constructs our obligation to Christ's commission now. We're ambassadors, brothers and sisters. There will be ambassadors appointed to foreign countries, and they'll live in the embassy. If whatever country on the world, in the world you're at, you go to a USA embassy and the Marines open the door and you step on the grounds of that embassy with the flag flying overhead, you might as well have stepped in Smith County, Virginia, because you are on official sanctified grounds, sovereign grounds of the United States of America. Boy, it feels pretty good when you're in a rough place and you go by and know y'all can step in that door and I'm home. Hallelujah to God. When you come to church this morning, you stepped in a heavenly embassy. We are fellowshipping together as ambassadors for Christ. We represent Him in this life. Anybody ought to be able to come on these grounds. I don't care if they're a drug addict or a drunk. I don't care if they're a Pharisee lost in the pride of religion. Everybody's welcomed underneath this crimson banner of love. Bring them to me, Jesus said, without stretched arms and blood dripping hands. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. You're on sovereign, holy, heavenly ground this morning. Hallelujah to God. He gets all the glory. He's the king. He's the president. He's the potentate. He's the almighty. Not me, not you, only Him. And he asked, "Oh, Peter, do you love me more than these?" So Peter finally said, "Lord, you know everything, and you know good and well I do." Now, the love of Christ constrains us, takes us into custody, verse 14. Henceforth, what's verse 16? Now, watch verse 15. And they that die, and that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. We live for Christ and to Christ. Henceforth, know we no man after the flesh. Yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. Because he's resurrected. We're new creatures in Christ. Look at that. Old things have passed away. All things become new. All things are of God who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ. He's the mediator of the New Testament. He died for sinners, touching sinners. He ascended to heaven, touching his Father. And now the cross is the bridge. across which any old rotten sinner like me can walk the walk of faith into the grace and glory of God. All those folks and you that came down here Thursday night, you walked to Jesus. You got saved by God's grace. And if you haven't been saved from sin and placed into salvation, you can do that right now. You don't have to wait for an altar call. You can come on right now. And finally and forever know what love is. May not like a lot of things people do, but you got to keep on loving their soul. He is our reconciliation. And watch this real carefully. Verse 19, God was in Christ reconciling the world unto himself. Listen closely and watch this. Not imputing their trespasses unto them. You got your Bibles over there, 2 Corinthians 5, verse 19. So trespasses, listen real close here. Trespasses were taken away from me into the body of my trespass offering. And he took my trespasses as my trespass lamb, burnt offering and sin offering. You done got it. You done jumped ahead and got it. That's why you grinning like a possum eating briars, about ready to shout. He took my sin and my trespasses all the way down into the consequential eternal results of sin, which is hell. And he left them there. I go to hell because of sin. But Jesus became sin. Well, glory. And he descended down with my sin. And he paid for my sin. And guess what? On the third day, he arose with righteousness. Now all my sin, they were all left in hell. Now as a repentant sinner, I'm saying, God, forgive me my sin. He's already paid the debt. It's done. So I'm washed. I'm forgiven. And now the only thing that is imputed is you can, what I am, you can become. In other words, let's put it this way. If you had a lot of debt to pay, you can pay it. And I was a gazillionaire and I loved you real good. And I went down to bank and I told Ariel, I said, y'all do me a favor. And she got the other people and they got your account number. And I told them all at the bank, they don't tell nobody, but put this $10 million in their account and then write them a letter and say, somebody that cares for you put $1 million in your account. Some of you ain't got it yet. And your checks now are good up to $5 million. Hallelujah to God. Hey, probably ain't nobody ever going to do that for me down here, but he did that for me 2,000 years ago. Thank God. Now he put all that in the account, and when I repented of my sin and got saved, he said, now all of my goods, everything that I am, everything that I have has been imputed unto you. It's been laid into your account and you can draw from it. Thank God I was not imputed with sin, with grumbling, complaining, gossip and pride. All that stuff got left down yonder in the pit. But he came back, he ascended to the palace of glory and he gave me access and imputed righteousness unto me. He who knew no sin, verse 21, was made sin that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Peter, do you love me more than these? Absolutely, Lord, because I saw you dead and now I've saw you alive and you've changed my life. Three times I denied you, but three times now I'm promising you I love you more than anything. Nero got him over there in Rome. They're making a big show out of that and they're crucifying him. And he said, by this death, Jesus saved my soul, but I'm not worthy to die like he did. And tradition says, he said, turn me upside down. I'll just get turned upside down if it means that some of y'all here in this courtyard can see my Jesus. because I love him more than my life. We've run like scared canaries from COVID, and that's all right. I know the mask, you should wear your mask. I got one in my pocket. You should stay away from people. I'm not flippantly saying that. But ladies and gentlemen, had we stayed away from church Thursday night because we were scared of COVID, oh my soul, I don't know how many got saved. It was 10, 12, I don't know how many. If one is worth it all, had we stayed away, look what would have happened. I'm telling you, do you love me more than anything? Do you love me more than your life? And it came down to that. And the scripture said over there, what death he would glorify God with. He glorified God even in his death. Do you love me more than these? Well, Philemon 18, Paul said to Philemon, old Onesimus, a runaway slave. He said, if he owes you anything, put that on my account. Whose account are we living on? If we're living on mine, I ain't got nothing but darkness and hate and criticism and judgmental attitudes and all the rest of it. But if I'm living on his account, I've got forgiveness, grace, tolerance, love of my soul. I've got everything that we will ever need. Son, I want you to know your mama is a shouting in heaven. And I know you've had a hard time, but love's going to get you through, David. I promise you. Oh, God Almighty's with you. He's with us in the struggles. He's with us in the troubles. He's with us every way. He loves us with an everlasting love. And when your heart is hurting, his heart is hurting. He'll be with you in everything, through everything, and beyond everything. And one of these days, love's going to deliver us all the way to the house. Over there in Luke 10, the Samaritan, good Samaritan, got that old boy out of the ditch, took him to an inn, told the innkeeper, whatever he owes you, I'll take care of it. I'm just living on the Lord's account. And you can draw out freely whatever you need. Would you look quickly at 1 Corinthians 13? Well, let's get these things. Love constrains our obedience to Christ's commands. We obey him because we want to. Constructs our obligation to Christ's commission. We want to do what Jesus said and go and help people. That's why we're trying to buy this house. People say, what are you doing that for? Because families in our region are hurting and destroyed. And this big old house up here on Rocky Hollow Road can house somebody that needs help, Crystal. That's what it's all about. You keep helping people, honey. Don't get frustrated when they don't take a drink. Jesus just wants you to lead the horse to the creek. You can either pull his old nose down, but it's up to him to drink. But you keep taking the horses to the creek, honey, because we love them. We don't love their drug addiction and their alcoholism. We don't love their old proud gossiping and tail-bearing either. But we know somebody that loves them too. He loves them too. So we've got to be obligated to his commission. And then look at this. Real love concludes our oneness with Christ's compassion. Compassion, Christ's compassion. That's charity. Look at the mercy here. And we won't try to hurry as fast as we can here, but everybody's Bible's open in 1 Corinthians 13. Here's mercy, not the big things that we do. The Corinthian church was so messed up, we won't have time, it'd take forever to teach the book of 1 Corinthians, but they was messed up on everything, including spiritual gifting. And so Paul said in verse 31, I show you a more excellent way of chapter 12, verse 31. And he says, if I speak with the tongues of men and angels, if I don't have charity, I'm a sounding brass and a tinkling cymbal. I'm an aggravation to God. If I have the gift of prophecy, understand all mysteries, all knowledge, and have all faith so that I can remove mountains, if I don't have charity, I'm nothing. Peter, do you love me more than these? Anything and everything in this world and everything in your life, even your own life? Boy, it's powerful. Though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, though I give my body to be burned, we can have Hadassah House, Freedom House. We can have a food pantry that is hard to keep stocked because of so many people in the area that needs help and they come here discreetly and privately and we feed all that. But if we don't have charity, the compassion of Christ active in our lives, it's nothing. We got to have mercy. And the same measure that we meet, it should be measured again. And the length of God's mercy should be the length of our mercy. Quickly now, here's might. You want to see might and strength and power? Charity is long-suffering and kind. It doesn't envy. My goodness, Brother David, if you get $1 million and get it the right way, I'll be the happiest fellow in the world. If you Cumberlands have the greatest farm in the state of Virginia, I'd be so pleased and proud. I'd be proud of y'all as if it was mine. We rejoice with those who rejoice. There's no jealousy in love. There's no envy. There's no criticizing. Only trying to energize each other. Love, charity, vaunteth not itself. It's not puffed up. Doesn't behave itself unseemly. Seeketh not her own. You're not going to have a good marriage if you don't try to meet the needs of someone else. You got to try to be helpful to your wife. Honor your wife above yourself. That's why I've told you, church, please, as we go into 21, there's people today, you know, they're split over doctrine. They're split over standards. There's people that they don't even know what they're talking about. They run down contemporary music and then they sing contemporary music. Just like Thursday night, some people don't like the music. People got saved during the music. You see, if some people like it, why can't you at least try to like it? That's charity. And they have all these excuses. I heard once they had those words go over and over and over. There's 26 verses in Psalms 136. Do you know how many times in those 26 verses that song lyric and that poetic style? See, they have names. Of, you never studied poetry, have you? You've never been to a music school. You never had theory of music. You don't understand that. But you heard some old preacher say, oh, that can be weird. So you repeat it. If God meant you to be a parrot, as Lakin used to say, he'd have put feathers on you. 26 verses, Psalms 136. 26 times it repeats over and over. His mercy endures forever. So you just opened your mouth and showed us your heart. It's not filled with the word. For obviously you haven't read the Psalms. And people criticize actual Psalms that are being sung. No wonder America's where it is today. No wonder you got people in power. They only want unity when you conform. They don't want unity, they want conformity. You be like me and we'll like you. But you ain't like me, we're going to hate you. So I was told a long time ago by a true man of God that the country reflects the condition of the church. So all my life I've seen churchgoers going to be my way or no way. God help. Now you got a country with leaders following that example. If you don't believe what we believe, you're out. Well, I'm sorry. My Lord's got me in and you can't get me out. I ain't bragging on nobody but him. But if we're going to see him move, I would to God that everybody would get in alliance. But I got a news flash. God told me to go on because every 5 or 10 that'll criticize and grumble, he'll send 500 that'll praise his holy name. And for everybody that walks away, he'll send somebody who will never walk away. Hallelujah to God. And you've already got the one who will never leave you and never forsake you. And you know what one of his names is? Love. God is love. So what do you say? Where did you get off on that, preacher? Charity doesn't seek its own. It's not easily provoked. Thinks no evil. Rejoices not in iniquity, but rejoices in the truth. Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things, and love never fails. there's mercy, might. And if we're going to have anything to really get involved with God, if you're going to be able to recognize the destiny that God has for you, you're going to have maturity. Verse 11, when I was a child, I spake as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. There it is. You're going to have some maturity and junk that immaturity. It ain't about you. It's about Jesus and a lost world. And it's all about us. And there's been many times through the years we're forced by love to step back and say, well, I'll respect my brothers and sisters and what they say or do. And if you're not willing to give, you're not worthy to get. It's that simple. And here's the secret that the devil exploits. The natural inclination, I got to take care of myself. I'm not going to give in. You fight your own fight your way, you'll never get to God. But when you die and crucify yourself and leave all of that junk where Jesus left it and recognize that you've been imputed with the fullness of His righteousness, then you can keep your mouth shut because you know He knows. And you know Him. And then about your little thing perpetuating that, you done got to fell in love with Jesus because your old person died with Him. And all that junk of Adam was left in hell. Now heaven showered you down with all the access codes to the treasure chest and storehouse of God. And you're able to forgive it. And now you're stepping out of self. And now you're stepping into Him. And now you're fixing to receive abundant life. And you'll love sinners. That's why you guys took all those hours, set that tent up. They didn't pay you. You don't get anything out of that. But you invested into the kingdom of God. Every time you start making investments, it just multiplies itself over and over. Because all you got's all His anyway, and the more you give up, the more you have access to. Then you know where the storehouse is, Verna Jean. It was all His that I given to Him anyway, and when I give everything that He's given me to Him, you know what? He lets me go into a deeper level of the warehouse, and then I get more and more and more and more and more. Hallelujah to God. If you'll see that this morning, it'll revive and revolutionize your life as a Christian. Stay immature if you want to. But you can grow up if you'd like. And now abides faith, hope, charity, these three. But the greatest of these is charity. We're going to close now, I promise you. Hebrews chapter 5. I've got to read you just a few more verses. And we'll be done. Do you love me more than these, Peter? Are you willing to give up yourself? Do you love me more than religion? Do you love me more than your own self? Do you love me more than all these? Love, charity, constrains our obedience to Christ's commandments, constructs our obligation to His commission, and concludes our oneness with Christ's compassion. Till we all come into the unity of the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect person under the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. I'm not there yet, neither are you. But we want to do more. We want to grow more. We want growth. We don't want to go back into perdition. You don't want to backslide into everything that Jesus died for. If you do that, you're crucifying Him afresh. If you do that, you're going to the flesh. If you do that, you're carnally minded. We do not want to backslide down into that Jesus already suffered to pay for and eradicate. We want to grow higher and higher and higher up the King's highway, growing in the knowledge of Christ. Verse 12, Hebrews 5, when for the time ye ought to be teachers, ye have need that one teach you again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for that person is a babe, immature, 1 Corinthians chapter 3. But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Now Jesus asked old Mike Sage a question this morning. Do you love me more than these? Because Peter, all those things out there have a tendency to backslide you back down into what I ever live to keep out of your life. But do you love me more than those? And if you do, when you were young, you went anywhere you want to. But son, when you're old, they're going to gird you. And they're going to take you where you don't want to go. But do you love me more than your own life? On Pentecost, that's why he boldly went up there and preached. And in Rome, when he come down to it, and they were buffing him and beating him and torturing him, spitting at him, tears running. In his heart, he remembered the words. Do you love me, Peter? And they shoved him down on that cross. You love that man, Jesus. How about this now? And they brought that Roman spike. Somehow another grace rose up in him. And he said, my Jesus died on the cross for my sin and yours. And I ain't nowhere near who he is. And I ain't worthy to die like him. Could you at least just put me head down? Boy, he couldn't breathe. He's suffering. But he was willing. Now you gonna tell me that you get upset over the least thing? When old Peter was willing to take 3 spikes and a cross. Because the man asked him a question 3 times. Do you love me more than these? Then be an example to my people and to my church. I'm the leader. You're the follower. But do all you can, Peter, to glorify me in every asset of your life. That's a Christian. Look out, devil. Look out, world. Look out, America. Look out, Democrats and Republicans. There's a few people out here in grassroots America that's having experiences and encounters. I'm saving, I'm healing, I'm still God. If you'll get out of my way and let me be God, and I want to use you to glorify myself, and it boils down to this. Do you love me more than these? To allow true Christ charity to drive you to be the best you can be for him and for his glory, and to get his grace to everyone else out here lost in this world. Let's pray. Dear God, I have tried my best to do what you wanted me to do and to say what you wanted me to say this morning. It's no sacrifice to give to you, because you bless abundantly. And the amount of your glory in any individual life is hinging upon the sacrifice and the level and depth and width of sacrifice of self that that person has offered to you. You gave 100% to us. You expect 100% from us. And may your charity drive the lives of this ministry, of each individual, and then collectively moving forward into 2021. In the sacred quietness of this moment, there's a sacred silence here. Do you really love Jesus more than these? Are you really saved? Do you know, really? What's the evidence in your life? I'm just wondering. Let's do a serious inventory. Now, in this sacred silence, you'd say, Brother Mike, I've got evidence of charity. I'm been long-suffering with people. I've sought the goodwill of others above my own desires and likes. I've not been selfish. I've been sacrificial. I can read the Bible, and I see things that characterize me as being a Christian according to the Bible. I'm not perfect, but I'm trying to be better every day. And I know as I start this new year, I am a Christian. Would you raise your hand and wave it a little bit and say, thank you, Lord. I know that I'm saved. Thank you. You'd say, Brother Mike, I honestly don't know. You baptized me. That ain't saving. I've been to church all these years. I didn't ask you that. I ask you, do you know in the bottom of your heart, and is there evidence in your life that you are a Christian and that you love Jesus more than anything else in the world? You say, preacher, when you put it like that, I have a little pause. I don't know for sure, but I want to know for sure. I'd appreciate you praying for me. Would you lift your hand up and let me pray for you? You say, Brother Mike, I don't know for sure. I just don't know. Don't fight it. Don't resist it. I don't care what time it is. You say, preacher, I'm not sure of my salvation. I'm just not. Would you lift your hand for prayer? Anyone. There were many in here that could not raise your hand that you knew you were saved. I'm just wondering. That's where the rubber meets the road. Do you know that you know that you know? And is there ample biblical evidence that you are a child of God? Let's all rise to our feet. Play softly just a little bit, Trish. You'd say, Brother Mike, my desire to the bottom of my heart